Good afternoon. I was glad when they said, unto us, let us go into the house of the Lord. This is our call to worship for the homegoing service, the celebration of life of Laurence Gillespie. As we look at the program, we have coming up scripture reading from Minister Jackie Tatum and Reverend Dr. Richard McMillan, followed by a comfort prayer by Reverend John J. Wilkins, Jr. And then we'll have a solo by Sister Karen Austin in that order.
Afternoon. Our prayer of comfort comes from the Old Testament. And as I sat with that thought for the Old Testament, I wanted it to be something not only familiar to those that believe, but to those that may not believe, but also know that it is a word that will bring comfort in times of loss and times of gain. And so today I want to go to Psalm 23. We learned it growing up, and we're going to learn it through the rest of our life. It's a Psalm of David. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup runs over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. These words for the people of God to comfort and also to bring strength. In Jesus' name, amen.
Our New Testament scripture comes from the book of Revelation, the 21st chapter. And I pray that these words will find comfort to the family and the friends that are gathered here this afternoon. And I saw a new heaven and a new earth. For the first heaven and the first earth were passed away, and there was no more sea. And I, John, saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down from God out of heaven, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a great voice out of heaven saying, behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and he will dwell with them, and they shall be his people, and and God himself will be with them and be their God. This is the verse that I want to leave with the family. And God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes. And there shall be no more death, nor crying, nor sorrow, neither shall there be any more pain. For these things have passed away. And he that sat upon the throne said, behold, I make all things new. I trust that these words will lift your spirit and God will put his arms around you. Amen.
Maybe pray together. Lord, we bow in humble submission that not our will, but your will has been done. It is your will from the beginning of his life until just the other day. He was in your hands, in your arms, in your care. You simply have come back and claimed that which is yours. But we say thank you for lending him to us all of these years. We pray that you would give this family peace and you would give them comfort. We need the Holy Ghost power to come and comfort us. For you said you would send us a comforter that would be with us at each stage of our lives. And we pray, Lord, that as this family go through the various stages of grief, we pray that they not linger too long at anger. Anger is a part of it. And so we pray that they linger not too long there, for you said for us to be angry, but to sin not. And so we thank you for that comforter. Now bring them together in a way that only you can. And so we surrender our will, our desires, all that we have capacity of, and we yield it to you. Lord, we thank you. Now, Lord, bind them together with the spirit of love and the spirit of peace and the spirit of comfort. For we know that you're able to do all things but fail. And we want them to continue to look unto Jesus, for he is the author and the finisher of our faith. Without him, we can do nothing. Without him, we are nothing. But because of him, we live. And we thank you because now he's in your presence. So you said, teach me to number my days that I might know how long I have to live. So just the other day you came and took him back from whence he came. Comfort each family member in a way that they need to be comforted. More than anything, we thank you for his legacy that is left behind. All those who are left, and help them not to spend much time trying to get over his passing, but learn how to live with it. I myself was in the same place a few days ago. I know you can. I know you're able. I know you're God. And besides you, there is none other. It hurts, but we thank you. As the scripture was already read, and God shall wipe away all tears from our eyes. And so we simply say, glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Thank God. Amen.
Oh, shall see his face. I shall see his I
I shall wear a crown. I shall wear a crown. We'll now have acknowledgments and resolutions from Sisters Pamela Jordan and Sharon Woods, followed by reflections from friends. Tacoa Bell, Michael Butler, Jay Lockhart, and Jason Taylor, followed by reflections from the family as you see in the program. It's time for the acknowledgments.
Resolution for a life well lived, Mr. Laurence Xavier Gillespie. Nothing is harder than losing someone you love, but friends can help the healing. Please know that you have sisters who care. He has said, I will never leave thee nor forsake thee, Hebrews 13:5. The ladies of 85 Degrees of Distinction, line of Delta Sigma Theta Sorority, Incorporated, wish to extend our deepest condolences to the family of Mr. Laurence Xavier Gillespie. Therefore, whereas Mr. Laurence Xavier Gillespie distinguished thyself as one such to be loved dearly from one of our own beloved Sorah, Phyllis Morrison, and whereas it has pleased our Heavenly Father to transfer dearly beloved Mr. Laurence Xavier Gillespie from the labors of this life to the sweet rest and fellowship of the saints in heaven. And whereas we, the members of the 85 Degrees of Distinction line of Delta Sigma Theta Sorority, Incorporated, desire to place on record our love and esteem for thy life and labor from this world, we thank the Heavenly Father for this and feel that we should express our sympathy to the family as well as to other friends. Be it therefore resolved that thy presence will be greatly missed by thy loved ones and thy family, friends, and community. To our beloved Sarah Phyllis Morrison of Richmond Hill, Georgia, and that the family accept the Christian submission of God's will, his calling home their beloved loved one, Mr. Laurence Xavier Gillespie. Be it further resolved that we will forever cherish thy memory, emulate thy admirable traits, and look forward with joy to meeting thee in the home being prepared in the glory land. Yes. Loving submitted by the on the 20th day of April 2024 of our Lord by the line sisters of Sarah Phyllis Morrison of 85 Degrees of Distinction of Delta Sigma Theta Sorority, Incorporated. Sisterly submitted, 85 Degrees of Distinction of Delta Sigma Theta Sorority, Benevolent Bereavement Committee. Church resolution for respect for Laurence Gillespie. No matter what your trials or how big your mountains seem, the Lord is there to see you through. He'll go to all extremes. So if your cross seems hard to bear and you know not what to do, the one who loves you most of all will be there to see you through. Author unknown. Whereas in the providence of God, he has brought to a close the life of Laurence Gillespie. The leaders and members of Hope Church International of Durham, North Carolina, feel that it's benefiting to express our sympathy to the family during the passing of Laurence Gillespie. We commend you to him, our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, who knoweth best. You have our sincere prayers. Be it resolved that we bow in humble submission to him who never makes a mistake and remind the family to be encouraged. For it is written in the word of God in 2 Corinthians 5:8, to be absent from the body and to be present with the Lord. Be it further resolved that a copy of this resolution be given to the family and a copy kept in the church archives. To the family, we know your loss is deep and your sorrow is great, but we want you to know that we have your sorrow. We share your sorrow. More importantly, we recognize that this loss is heaven's gain. Humbly submitted on the 20th day of April, 2024, the leaders and members of Hope Church International, Durham, North Carolina, Pastor Nathaniel Fuller, Senior Pastor. Markham Chapel. Letter of condolences and loving memory of Laurence Xavier Gillespie. A hush is over all the 10 lists, and there is pause, a breath space in the strife. A spirit brave has passed beyond the mist and vapors that obscure the sun of life. He knew the import of his master's call and felt himself too mighty to be small. His heart, his talents, and his hands were free to all who truly needed aught of him. He died in action with his armor on, Paul Laurence Dunbar. The master in heaven, the master of his very soul, sweetly and gently called Laurence Xavier Gillespie to eternal rest. Without any reservation that the time had come to receive his crown of righteousness, Laurence quickly yielded to the call. Therefore, the entire congregation of Markham Chapel Missionary Baptist Church joins with me in extending great deep love and heartfelt sympathy to his wife, Sarita, his children, Malachi, Talia, and Lauren, and his entire family. Laurence was no stranger to our congregation. He last worshiped with us on December 24, 2023. His signature was his gentle smile, which he always wore when greeting us. We pray that you are comforted with us in the knowledge that the life was manifested and we have seen it testify to it, and we proclaim to you the eternal life which was with the Father and has appeared to us. 1 John 1:2. Confident in this, the entire congregation and family of Markham Chapel Missionary Baptist Church bow to humbly submission to the will of God. Blessed be God, even the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercies and the God of all comfort. We pray that hurting hearts will find solace in the comfort wherewith ourselves are comforted of God. 2 Corinthians 1:3-4. We love you. Humbly submitted, Pastor Richard S. McMillan, the officers and congregation of Markham Chapel Missionary Baptist Church. First American Missionary Baptist Church. Resolution for Mr. Laurence Xavier Gillespie. To Phyllis Morrison and family, I give unto them eternal life. We, Christian friends, have the promises of God that death, which people fear most, shall be to us the most blessed of experience, dependent upon our perfect trust in him. Death in unclasping earth's tawdry treasures is breaking out in the desert. The heat, the heart comes to it, blooming time. Strength, Lord, make me strong. Let my soul rooted be afar from veils of rest. Flung close to heaven upon a great rock's breast, unsheltered and alone, but strong in thee. Lord, plant my spirit high upon the crest of thine eternal strength. Then, through life's breaking struggle, come at length, the storm shall only bend me to thy breast. Resolved, a copy of this resolutions be sent to the family of the deceased and with our sincere and deepest felt sympathy. Sorrowfully submitted, First African American Baptist Church. And Beacon Light Missionary Baptist Church. Resolutions. Whereas, in the providence of God, he has brought to a close the life of Laurence Gillespie. And whereas, we humbly submit to the will of God with deep reverence, honor, and memory of our beloved brother in Christ, who grew up among us, participating in many youth activities. And whereas, Laurence was a beacon of joy and a testament of the love of Christ, always greeting us with a smile that reflected the happiness of his youth. And whereas, he committed his life to Christ at an early age, living out his faith with sincerity and a spirit of service, touching the lives of many within our congregation. Be it resolved that we, the members of Beacon Light Baptist Church, recognize that our congregation has lost a cherished member whose spirit will continue to dwell in the hearts of those he touched. And be it further resolved that we express our deepest sympathy to the family of Laurence Gillespie, offering them our prayers and support during this time of bereavement. And be it finally resolved that a copy of this resolution will be given to the family of Laurence Gillespie and a copy kept in the church archives, as a testament to the life and contributions to our church community. Humbly submitted this 20th day of April, 2024, Janetta Jordan, church clerk, and Dr. Clarence H. Burke, pastor.
I'll be reading some of the many cards and acknowledgments shared with the family. God's promises. When sorrow comes, God's promises are shining rays of hope that break through cloudy skies to bring us warmth. He promises to love us and to hear our every prayer, to comfort us and to guide us, and to always just be there. He promises to give us strength to weather any storm, to be someone we lean on who will keep us safe and warm. God will never leave us all alone when skies are gray. As long as we believe and trust, his love will light our way. Praying for his healing to soften the sadness and to bring you peace. So sorry for your loss. Love, the Rhodes family. May the love of God give you peace. May the caring of friends give you comfort. May the memories of the one you've lost remain in your heart and give you strength through the days ahead. Love, Tanetta Robinson. The bond of love is for always. Through everything you and your husband share together, the years you loved each other, the warmth and caring between you, you created a special bond that will always be a part of you. Hoping you find comfort now in that very special love, a love that will last forever. In sympathy, praying God's strength and comfort upon you all. Tony Alston Mayo. A journey remembered. As some people journey through life, they leave footprints wherever they go. Footprints of kindness and love, courage and compassion, humor and inspiration, joy and faith. Even when they're gone, we can still look back and clearly see the trail they left behind, a trail bright with hope that invites us to follow. Praying you'll be comforted with precious memories and God's presence to care for you and your loss with sympathy. Love, Cassandra. Mrs. Morrison, I just learned about Laurence's passing through one of my former students. I taught Laurence in the eighth grade at Carrington Middle School, and he was one of those students you don't forget. He was a light in this world, and I wanted to let you know I'm praying for you and your family. I can't imagine. May God give you the strength and comfort in the days ahead. And this is from Justin Knox Burgess. In loving memory of our wonderful son, during this time of profound loss, we find solace in the beautiful moments we shared with Laurence, the first child born of our hearts. Though his time on earth was brief, his journey was filled with love, kindness, and unforgettable joy. He loved deeply and unconditionally, forming bonds that are both sacred and eternal. His legacy lives on in his beautiful children, in the stories we tell, in the memories we cherish, and in the love that binds us together. Although our hearts are hurting, and the tears refuse to stop, we hold on to believe that love never dies. It simply transforms, transcending the boundaries of this earthly plane, uniting us with those we love through an eternal bond. The Bible tells us, but I do not want you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning those who have fallen asleep, lest you sorrow as others who have no hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so, God will bring with him those who sleep in Jesus. For this we say to you by the word of the Lord, that we who are alive and remain until the coming of the Lord will by no means precede those who are asleep. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of an archangel, and with the trumpet of God. And the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we are alive and remain, shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And thus we shall always be with the Lord. Therefore, comfort one another with these words. 1 Thessalonians 4th chapter 13 through the 18th verses of the New King James Version. Laurence, of all the special gifts in life, however great or small, to have you as our son was the greatest gift of all. May the winds of love blow softly and whisper in your ear, we love and miss you, son, and wish that you were here. Deep in our hearts, your life is kept to love and to cherish, not to forget. No more tomorrows can we share, but yesterdays are always there. A silent thought, a secret tear, keeps your memory ever near, in our hearts forever. Loving you eternally, Mommy and Dad.
So when Pia volunteered to put me on these reflections, I looked at her because I don't do public speaking. But somehow I keep finding myself in a public speaking, so maybe God's trying to tell me something. This one was hard for me because I couldn't find the words for what I... He's the first friend I've lost, or person that I consider a friend. And I started something. Those who know me know I communicate poetically, but I couldn't finish it, so I'm gonna read what I started. I'm sorry. When I first met Lawrence, he was just the guy that was stealing all my friends' attention. And did I mention he had her mind in a whole nother dimension? He came in and swept my sister right off her feet. I knew I couldn't compete with this new love that she kept so discreet. In time, I finally got the official meeting, and he flashed his smile with every greeting. They moved into the building next to me. I'd see more of my friend finally. I walked down that sidewalk faithfully to hang out with my new family. I brought food at Tom's game, sometimes just myself I carried. Lord's response sometimes varied. As he asked his wife, does Tacoa realize you're married? I feel held back a little bit, and they moved further away. But every week, me and Shakaya eagerly waited for Sunday. We get together at the Gillespie house for our Sunday meal. During the summertime, it was almost always grilled. By this time, I had grown on Lawrence, and he was happy to see me. He'd always be ready to binge a series or tell me about a new movie. That's as far as I got. But I got on Lawrence's nerves at first. And he got on mine, because my best friend, we've been thick as thieves since kindergarten. But Lawrence was the entertainment of every gathering. Between us cracking on each other and him, he never cooked anything, but swore out, if he flipped a piece of chicken, he made the whole meal. So then he got so, I told Shruti the other day, because she didn't even know, he would text me, because we cook on the grill, and he would have a request, and Sharita would shut it down sometimes. So he'll text me and say, sis, ask Rita to put some shrimp on something on the grill. I know she done already told me no, but I know she gonna tell you yes. So I asked her, and she showed, put that on the grill, so he get his shrimp. But Lawrence really taught me how to smile through anything. And that's the biggest part I remember about him, just his smile and his positive attitude towards things that were thrown his way. And that's something I will forever take with me. So rest, brother. I'm gonna miss you.
So I met Lawrence my junior year transfer at Northern, him and Micah. Always a smiling, happy, outgoing. I remember I was telling the parents when I went to visit the hospital. I remember days they came to Bahama. We tried to go cow tipping. We seen on a movie, we was like, man, let's try it. Like every what, Friday, Saturday? We'll go out there and try it. We came close a couple times, but a cow just wake up and look at you, and we just run away. I remember one night we left. It was a car coming down the road, and Micah didn't jump in the car, and we left him, and he just ran to the ditch. So we went to the store and turned around, and we just laughed about it. And it's crazy because when I was training for college, play football, I always used to go work out every day. And seeing the dad at the hospital, he was like, man, you remember when me and Lawrence was working out with you? I had to think about it. I was like, wow, like, time goes so fast, forget about things. So even in that stuff, Lawrence always smiled, whether it's conditioning, playing football, he'll make you laugh. Whether it's lifting and he tired, you gonna laugh. Whether we went 0-11 my junior year, and Lawrence was still smiling, laughing. Everybody else was like, man, he was like, man, just smiling. So, like I said, his spirit still lives on. The only thing I can tell the family is, hold on to your memories. Like, that's the only thing you got left. It's going to be hard at first, but over time, you'll start smiling. You'll be okay. You'll make it. If you need me, just call me. I'm going to text away anything. Just call me.
I met Lawrence when I was in the seventh grade. Thinking back, he's responsible for a lot of who I am, a lot of firsts. He was responsible for my first fight. That should have never happened. Then just like growing up, I say we became like best friends in like the 10th grade, sitting on the bench, laughing, not getting in. Laurence used to do this thing, he'd be like, "Coach called you to come in." You run the coach, "Coach, I didn't call you." then I say like maybe junior year going into senior year, that's when we like became like brothers. We practically live with each other, either at y'all house or at my house. I don't have a physical brother, but Laurence probably like the first friend that I had, like the longest friend that I had that really turned into a brother. I got a story, but first I'm gonna say I thank y'all for accepting me and treating me like y'all own. But Miss Phyllis didn't play. One night we went to a party, and he was like, "I gotta be at home by 12, bro. Gotta be at home by 12." So I thought, okay. So I had a curfew too. I just wasn't honoring it that night. So we was running late. Somebody was with us. I can't remember who it was. They was like, "Can you stop at the store?" Lauren said, "No, we're not stopping at no store." But I was driving, though. He said, "We're not stopping at no store, bro." So we pull up in front of the house. It was like 11:58. I know for a fact because we joke on them all the time. Lawrence ain't dap nobody up. He got out the car, and it won't like no mile-long driveway. It's like your average driveway. Lawrence got out the car and ran to the garage. So we laughing at him. And I was like, "Bro, it's 11:58. He said, "Bro, when she say 12, she really mean 11:59. But yeah, no, we had a lot of fun times like that. He was definitely a prankster, a jokester, stuff like that. But yeah, no, I'm gonna miss him. And like I said, I love y'all.
Anybody? We hear from Jay Lockhart. Okay. Now we will move on with reflections from the family in the order as you see them. As you have heard several times, Laurence loved to smile. And it's interesting that that's what we remember about him. So come on, family, and share your reflections.
A little bit when first came around,
Harrison, followed by Cameron and Cedric and Sharita.
It has been a while since I've been here. First of all, Aunt Phyllis and Uncle Larry, thank you for this opportunity to share a few words about Laurence, and I'm honored to celebrate his life. Laurence is the first cousin I had on my father's side. I'm the oldest of all the grandkids, and Laurence was the first friend I was born with. I prayed a lot over the last few weeks. Laurence and I text and talked every week of our life. We spent a ton of time together, but we talked a lot over these last few weeks, and I prayed and talked to God a lot. I knew based on what he was dealing with that it would require a miracle. So that's exactly what I prayed about. I prayed faithfully to God and talked to God about what Laurence was dealing with. And this past Sunday, I woke up in the middle of the night and heard a voice. I believe it was God. And God said to me, Harrison, the miracle's done. I've completed the miracle. And, I sat and pondered for a second. I told my wife when she woke up what I experienced. And the miracle is I was gifted Laurence. You know, I'm similar to my son. I thrive in social environments. I love my friends. I am very loyal to all my family members and friends. And Laurence was the friend I needed as a kid. My sister's 7 years younger than I am, so I wasn't born with a biological brother. But Laurence is the first friend that I had at one. If I can share a story, my Aunt Phyllis and my Uncle Larry were the first to take me to Orlando with Laurence and Douglas. We rode in the back of that burgundy Camry. I don't know if I remember. And this is when I learned, this is a pivotal moment in my life. I've never shared this with you all. But Laurence, Douglas, and I got into a debate. Our debate was around, they were reflecting on being foster kids. They were reflecting on being adopted and being their older cousin. I said, nuh-uh, it's not true, because I was so close to them. And there's no way that we aren't biologically related. And my Aunt Phyllis gave me one of those looks. She turned around and she said, they're right. But that doesn't make them any less of your family. And as a matter of fact, from that moment on, I think I pulled them closer to me. We grew up in Durham, High Point, Thomasville, and in between going to camps, football practice, basketball practice, neighborhoods, and we called ourselves the Gillespie Boys. We would proudly walk into your driveway, and we were confident that we could take on anyone. If someone stole a ball, we were willing to go back and fight for it. And we talked about everything. We laughed and talked and got in trouble together. Laurence is the best friend I could ever ask for. He's truly a miraculous gift. As I hear these reflections from his various friends and family members, I am affirmed in what I heard this past Sunday, which is he was, in fact, a miraculous human being. So I rest in peace. I'm at peace today and after that moment. I was sad up into that moment, but I'm at peace today because God has reminded me of what a blessing life is through Laurence and what a blessing it is to have a friend. I see a lot of purple and gold in the room, so I know you all know what I'm talking about, but there's no greater gift than a friend, especially in the way that Laurence was brought into my life. And I just want to say that I am grateful to God that that he put the courage, the love, the joy, and the vision in my Aunt Phyllis and my Uncle Larry to go and pick up this baby at such a young age and bring him home and bring him into our family and bring him to everything and bring him to me. And allow me to share this friendship, allow me to stay at the house every week, come to this church often, and go to our grandparents during the summers, and I'm just so grateful for that, and I'm grateful that Laurence has shared his smile with you all. He shared with me as well. and that's it. You know, I'm at peace. I'm grateful that Laurence is being celebrated today, and I celebrate with you all. I love you, Laurence. I cannot wait until we can talk again and reflect on the things that we've learned throughout our childhood as well as during our now manhood. And again, I just thank you, Aunt Phyllis and Uncle Larry, for gifting me Laurence.
I'm going to read a few things and then I'll share a story. A first cousin is not only your family, but your first childhood friend. They attend your early birthday parties and other milestones growing up. You learn how to play and fight with your first cousins. Before I had childhood friends, I had two first cousins who fit the description. One of them was Laurence. Growing up, I always enjoyed my cousins, Douglas, Laurence, and Felicia, when they came to Georgia or when I went to North Carolina with my parents or by myself during the summer school break. We had a great time together. A memory that Laurence and Felicia and I often talk about is the Summer Reading Institute at their house. We could play and stay up all we wanted to as long as we read those some books and answered those oral constructive response questions. Douglas and Felicia normally and always read the books and answered the questions correctly. Laurence and I did not. I really did not. So Laurence, Douglas and Felicia had went downstairs and gave their report and everything. Laurence went down, and I know Laurence didn't read no book. He didn't read nothing the whole time. So Phyllis called Laurence down. Laurence went down, and then he came back up. I thought he was getting in trouble, but he was smiling. And then my name got called, and then he would just be laughing. I'm like, dude, this is not funny. Like I'm trying to come up with something. So apparently Laurence finessed and said something that made him go back upstairs without getting in trouble. And I went downstairs and couldn't answer the first question. What is the title of the book? So I got called downstairs, and I was walking slow down the steps. And Laurence was like, you're taking too long. Let's go, go, go. He said it real loud, so she would know that I was taking too long. And then I got in trouble. And then I went back upstairs, and man, they were just dying laughing. They was dying laughing. So Laurence told me at least finesse. Finesse a little bit if you're not going to read finesse, so I learned that from him. As an adult, when we would see each other, we would talk for a while, and I really enjoyed in those talks that we had with either it was one-on-one or with all the cousins and my brother. This has, I know, been rough for everybody, but I do pray that the family, his wife and his children, my Aunt Phyllis, Uncle Larry, Felicia, Douglas, his grandmother, everyone will find peace, have more days of joy and peace than grief. I'm definitely going to miss him. I'm glad that everyone came before me, they gave me some peace so I can get up here and say this. Thank you.
First and foremost, thank you to Phyllis and Larry for allowing me to be included with family. That young man was every bit my little brother. And the nature of my relationship with him, as well as a lot of his peers I see in the audience today, I was old enough to be respected as an adult and role model, but I was young enough to still be cool. And I say that in that, you know, we had a unique relationship where, you know, they could talk to me about anything, you know, things they didn't want to talk to their parents about. You know, I wasn't, you know, I'm old enough, but I wasn't too far removed from what they were dealing with on a daily basis. You know, so a lot of reflection this week. And, you know, as family, I remember being present for all the milestones, the birthdays, the cookouts. You know, I remember at a certain point, Laurence got to a certain age where he didn't want Phyllis and Larry at his birthday parties anymore. And he asked me to chaperone. And, you know, I didn't realize the significance of that at the time. You know, but there's a lot of trust and responsibility that comes with playing that role. You know, it's impossible for, so when I think of milestones, the most important milestone that I was present for was the day Laurence accepted Christ. Yes. And, you know, that's the milestone I've reflected on most this week, because it gives me peace. Now, it's impossible for me to separate Laurence and his friend group. You know, when I think of them, they rolled in the pack. And with any pack of animals, any pack of friends, any friend group, they all have distinct personalities. You know, you have a fighter. You know, you have the antagonist. You have, you know, the filler. You have all these personalities. Laurence was the nice guy. And I say that with sometimes best said, you know, meekness is mistaken for weakness. But I say niceness in the highest compliment. And I believe vulnerability and showing that is the highest test of manhood. And to know Laurence, you know, I've known him his entire life, and he had that same look his entire life. This look of innocence, this look of sweetness. You know, you look in his eyes, there's a softness to his eyes. You know, vulnerability and acceptance. You know, it made you smile, it made you happy, as many have reflected. So I think of this group, and I mentioned the group because, you know, I had a lot of very pivotal moments with this group. You know, I think specifically I was thinking of a few stories. You know, one thing we did at the church, and a lot of these young men are here and will remember this, we used to have lock-ins. And I was a chaperone. And, you know, we'd get together, we'd go out there and play football. You know, I'd show them that I could still show them up. We would we'd come in and eat, and then we'd talk. You know, maybe watch a movie, but they would open up, and we'd talk about girls, we'd talk about life, we'd talk about school, we'd talk about challenges. And it was an open forum for them to be able to say anything and express themselves and know it would be accepted and we could talk through it. And then there would come a point in the night when, you know, I would sleep back there and they would all congregate somewhere up here and they thought I was asleep, but I could hear them talking. And they stayed up talking all night. And I've never told them this, but, you know, I probably got more of those nights than they did. So on a lighthearted note, you know, we talk about the pureness and the innocence and just the wonderful human being Laurence was. Along with that, he was consistent. You know, one thing he was, Laurence was a terrible liar. my man wasn't good at lying, you know, because he was so pure hearted. You know, I remember vivid examples where I would get calls of, you need to talk to your boy. I remember one time he attempted to change his report card with an ink pen. And I, like, you know, not even high tech, just literally crossing out grades and changing him to a different grade and expecting that to be accepted and would present it to his parents with a straight face. You know, I remember Laurence going to school in one outfit and coming home in a different outfit because he'd throw his clothes in the trash can and wear what he wanted to wear. But, you know, just you know, kind-hearted mischievousness, you know, that we all go through as young men, but Laurence just wasn't as good as some are at it. I Was eating lunch yesterday, and I was thinking about Laurence, and I saw a quote on the wall that said, men shouldn't fear death, but men should fear never beginning to live. And although his time on earth was short, Laurence lived a good life. Laurence made an impact on a lot of people. You can tell through the reflections. And Laurence had a purpose. And I'm appreciative of just having Laurence in my life and being able to play a small role in his development and being able to call him a brother. So family, just rest in peace, as someone else said, with the memories and reflections. And you know, there's a lot of them. There's a lot of stories. We'll continue to tell them. But Laurence lived a good life. Rest in peace, brother.
Good afternoon. So I met Laurence in 2013 when, I don't know why I did, but decided to work a part-time job at UPS. And he was one of the first people that I met. He saw that I was struggling with the scanner, and I was just like, no, I don't need any help. But by the time the shift started, I was like, hey, Laurence, I need your help. And he was willing to help. And later down our journey, we, you know, decided to date. And I don't know why, but I was just nervous. And I was like, well, I'm not hungry. I don't want to eat. I'm, you know, fasting. I said something like that. And he still decided to take us to a buffet. And he's eating chicken, like, oh, it's good. You don't want to try none? I'm like, no, I'm just going to, you know, eat my salad and my vegetables. But you were right. I was trying to be cute. But I'm going to miss him, his gentleness, always being concerned that I'm okay, even though he may not have been okay. But you fought hard, and I thank you for everything that you gave me while you were here, and I will always love you.
Thank you for those beautiful reflections. And now we'll have another selection by Karen Austin, accompanied by Stephen Jones.
Cometh my help. My help cometh from the Lord, the Lord which made heaven and earth. He said he will not suffer my foot to be moved. The Lord that keepeth slumbers nor sleeps, for the Lord is my keeper, the Lord is my shade. Upon my right hand, upon my right hand, though the sun shall not smite me by day, nor the moon by night, he shall preserve my soul, even forevermore. My head, cometh my help. My help cometh from to be
reflections of Laurence. And I have to say that I'm so glad that the reflections were consistent. Amen. About his nature. You see, I've stood here times where I hear a different side of a person than what I knew them as. But I'm so glad that I can't say that about Laurence. Because everything they said was true. We have come here to celebrate Laurence today. Amen. Haven't we come to celebrate his life and the part he played in our lives? It might seem strange to some that we use the word celebrate during a time like this. But for people of faith, we see this as a transition into another life. So therefore, we can celebrate. We can celebrate and still be sad at the same time. We can celebrate and still be weepy at the same time. So therefore, tears are appropriate during times like this. And for so many of your peers, Lawrence's peers, this might be the first friend you lost. So this is difficult for you. This is very difficult to you. But as we celebrate, we come to say our final farewell to Lawrence today. Although we feel that his untimely death might have cheated us of his presence, we still celebrate the years that God granted Lawrence to be with us. So therefore, let us open up with prayer. Father, I thank you. I thank you for Lawrence. I thank you for his family, Lord. I just thank you for his presence, Lord. I thank you for how he made us feel at ease in his presence. And Lord, I just pray that you be with his family and his friends, Lord. And not just today, but in the coming days and months and years. And let them reflect on him with happy thoughts. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen. While my faith and my training has prepared me to deal with difficult circumstances, you have to realize the only thing that separates me from you is that I ask the same questions that you do. There is nothing that separates me from you. I still ask the same questions of why. Why did this have to happen like this? Why did this have to happen? And there's some things that we will not get answers to on this side of glory. Yes. But I'm so glad that we have a comforter who can comfort us during these difficult times. And that comforter is Jesus Christ. Yes. And for people of faith, we lean on that comforter to help us and support us. We will still cry. We will still mourn. But we know that Lawrence had given his life to Christ. So see, he's all right. As I look around the room, I see several generations of people who have come to celebrate him. I see his family who raised him. I see friends who played with him, who hung out with him. I learned something about Lawrence from the friends today. I see his wife and children who depended on him, his parents who raised him. I see his church family who remembered him as that pleasant young man with that beautiful smile. You see, the picture you see on the screen, that's how I choose to remember Lawrence. And as I was sitting there and I was looking, I could just still see him standing, ushering at that back door, wearing black pants, white shirt, black tie, with a smile on his face. Not always knowing when somebody needed to come in because he'd be just so happy and doing the service. But Lars would be back there in his own world sometimes. It was easy to love Lawrence. When you ask Lawrence how he was doing, quite often he'd simply say, "I'm good. I am good." You are here because you love Lawrence. Some of you hung out with him. You loved his family, and some of you even had the pleasure of sitting under the table in his mother's kitchen to eat that wonderful food. Now Lawrence is gone. Whereas some of us would like to hide away and mourn in private, we have to realize that we need each other during times like this. Amen. These are the difficult times. We can't believe that this is the end of Lawrence as we know him. But I can reassure you that as a child of God, this is not the end of Lawrence, but a transition into a life with God. Yes. How do I know this? Because the Bible tells us so. Yes. What's that song we learned in Sunday school? Yes.
Jesus loves me.
Yeah.
This I know.
Yeah.
For the Bible tells me so.
Yes, sir.
Little ones, to him belong. They are weak,
yes,
but he is strong.
Yes.
Lawrence was weak in the last few years, but he served a strong God.
Yes.
He depended on strong God, and he had a praying family,
yes,
who looked after him.
Yes.
We might be crushed. We might be confused. We might be looking for someone to answer the question, why? Some might feel that life was not fair to Lawrence over the last few years. But for a few minutes, let me introduce you to somebody else whose life was not fair to, that we might see. Let me tell you about a man named Jesus.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
A son sent by the Father to suffer for us.
Yes.
He came to alleviate the suffering that we feel, yes, right now.
Yes.
Jesus understands how we feel right now.
Yes.
How do I know? Because I look at his word and I see that he shed tears,
yes, sir,
when his friend Lazarus had died.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Jesus was despised. He was rejected. He was crucified by the very same people that he came to save.
Yes.
But by dying, Jesus removed the penalty of death, giving his life as a sacrifice,
yes, uh-huh,
for our sinfulness,
yes,
and to remove the offense that separated us from God.
Yes.
But I'm so glad that we talk about Jesus, that that was not where the story ended.
Yes, sir.
Amen.
It did not end on the cross.
Yes, sir.
It did not end on the grave, in the grave, but in 3 days,
yes, sir,
he rose again.
Yes, sir.
How do I know? Because there are eyewitness accounts of those who saw the resurrected Jesus.
Yes, sir.
There are those who walked with him, those who talked with him, those who touched him. By faith, we acknowledge that Jesus conquered death.
Yes, sir.
Conquered death.
Oh, my God.
And by conquering death, he proved that he is the Son of God,
yeah,
who is able to give life to those who trust in him.
Yeah.
Jesus is the one who paved the way for Lawrence to have eternal life.
Yes, sir.
Yes, he did.
Lawrence was not perfect.
Come on, God.
But who is?
Yeah.
Who is, yeah, perfect?
Yeah. Yeah.
That's why God had to send his Son.
Yeah.
A perfect Savior for an imperfect people.
That's good,
thank
God.
You, Lord.
Yes. God's plan.
Yes.
And this is to you who are not people of faith, who might be wondering why we are celebrating with happiness.
Yes, sir.
For those who have lost their first friend in life, let me tell you that life does not end.
Yes.
For people of faith.
Yes, sir.
God had a plan for us, and he still has this plan,
yes,
for all those who are willing to receive it.
Yes. Yes.
Romans chapter 3, verse 23 says, for all have sinned,
yes,
and fallen short of the glory of God. We are not a perfect people,
yes,
but we serve a perfect,
perfect
God.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
Romans 5, 8 tells us, but God demonstrated his own love towards us, in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us.
Yes, sir.
Going on to Romans chapter 6, 23.
Yes.
It tells us, for the wages of sin is death.
Yes.
But the
gift
of God is eternal life.
Yes, sir.
In Christ Jesus our Lord.
Yes.
You know, a gift is something that you didn't earn.
Yes.
A gift is something you don't deserve.
Yes.
A gift is given because the giver loves you so much.
Yes, sir.
That they wish to give it to you.
Yes.
God gave us a gift.
Yes.
That is the reason that we can celebrate today amidst our tears, because God gave us a gift.
Yes.
That gift of salvation, but he also gave us the gift of Lawrence in our lives.
Yes.
Yes, sir.
Some might wonder, how can I obtain this gift of salvation? I'm glad inquiry minds really want to know.
Yes.
that's where we turn again to Romans chapter 10, verse 9, which simply says that if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead,
yes, sir,
you will be saved.
Yes.
For with the heart one believes unto righteousness,
yes,
and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation.
Yes.
That is God's plan for us, activated 2,000 years ago, but is still in effect unto this day.
Yes.
And with his plan, he also left us some promises. And family, I pray that these promises will bring comfort to you. Mm-hmm. Number one, John 1 verse 12 says, but as many as received him, to them he gave the right to become children of God.
Yes.
To those who believed in his name. John 3:16 says, for God so loved the world.
Yes.
That he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him shall not perish,
yes, sir,
but have everlasting life.
Yes, sir.
Jesus even said himself in John 6:46, most assuredly I say to you, he who believes in me has everlasting life.
Yes.
And when Jesus tells Martha, the sister of Lazarus, that her brother will rise again.
Yes.
In John 11, verse 25, it says, I am the resurrection,
yes, sir,
and the life.
Yes.
He who believes in me, though he may die, he shall live.
Yes.
And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. Do you believe this?
Yes.
And for the family, that's the question I want to leave you with today. Do you believe this?
Yes.
Do you believe that he died in Christ? Do you believe that he died to live again?
Yes.
We can't appreciate it now. But for those in close contact with Laurence knew how much he suffered over the last few years.
Yeah.
For those who have prayed for him and with him or visited him during his hospital stays, you know how much he struggled and suffered.
Yeah.
I wonder sometimes how hard is it to keep a smile on your face when you're struggling to take your next breath.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. I wonder how hard is it to keep a smile on your face when you're measuring your steps before you begin walking because you're wondering how far can you walk.
My God.
Yeah. How hard is it to tell your friends when they ask you how you are doing?
Yes.
How hard is it to say, I'm good?
Yes.
When you know that your health is preventing you from enjoying the life that you want to. But he kept a smile on his face. Regardless of how he felt, he kept a smile on his face.
Yes, sir.
After his recent surgery, for a few hours, he was the Laurence that we remembered. We were all optimistic that everything was going to go as the doctors planned. He woke up. They took him off the ventilator. He smiled. He joked. And he texted that I am good.
Yeah. Amen. Amen.
But then he lapsed into a non-communicative state until he passed. And to the family, I prayed. And I wonder, why did you allow Laurence to recover like that? Only to take him away.
Yes.
But the answer came to me that God gave you one last time to see him.
Yes, sir.
God gave you one last time to see that beautiful smile.
Yes, sir. Yes.
To enjoy him before he took him away.
That's good. Yep. That's good.
One last time to simply say, I'm good.
Yes. That's good. That's good, Doc. That's good.
Why is Laurence good? Because Laurence is no longer suffering.
Yes, sir.
He is no longer in pain.
Yes.
He is good because he is a child of God.
Yes.
He has submitted his place in the kingdom.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. And as I reflected on this, I was thinking about the song so long ago,
yes,
by Reverend James Cleveland.
Yes.
That song simply is, God has smiled on
yes,
me.
Sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
He has set me free.
Yes, sir.
God has smiled
yes, sir.
On me.
Yes.
He's been good
yes.
to me.
Yes.
Family, he's free.
Yes.
Friends, he's free.
Yes.
Relatives, he's free.
Yes.
Free from the aches and pains of the body. He's free from measuring each breath before he took a separate step, a single step. He is free. For us, we must remember
yeah.
that he is free.
Yes.
He is free.
Yes.
Let us appreciate the time that we had with them. Let us appreciate the moments we had with them. And I'm so glad to have been part of Lawrence's family. Even when I had to talk to him during tough times, when he did something wrong,
yes.
he wouldn't brood long. Afterwards, the smile would return. As if he was saying, I'm good.
I'm good.
This morning I got up and I looked outside and saw the sky, and it reminded me of a little debate Laurence and I had. See, Laurence had an affinity for a university in the city of Durham. That wore a different shade, a certain shade of blue.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I remember talking to him, and I looked at the clouds today, and I remember one time telling Lawrence, I said, look at the sky, what color is it? He said, light blue.
Yes.
Look at the clouds, what color are they?
Yeah.
They are white.
Yeah.
And I said, you tell me God's not a Tar Heel.
Praise God.
And Lawrence still smiles. I will remember Lawrence. He is part of our family. We will remember Lawrence. But I encourage you, as you remember Lawrence, just be thankful for the time you had with Lawrence. Be thankful and support this family. Because it's going to be tough. In days, weeks, months, years ahead. Because there is a hole in their heart. I know they'll appreciate your calls, your visits. But there will come a time in the midnight hour when nobody is on the phone and nobody is texting. I encourage you, family, to lean on your faith and lean on the Lord. And remember that God is our refuge and our strength, a very present help in trouble.
Yes, yes,
so God bless you.
Yes.
God bless you.
Yes.
Lawrence, a person who touched everybody who met him. Lawrence, a person who tried his best to obey the rules. Lawrence, that obedient child. That child that always had that smile on his face. Spoke few words at times, but was always willing to do everything. I reflect on him standing right here years ago, participating in an oratorical contest. He didn't want to do it, because you had to memorize your speech. If I remember correctly, it was 3 minutes long. He didn't want to do it, but he did it. He did it anyway. And I thank God for examples like him that are willing to stretch beyond their comfort zone
yes.
and do things that they normally would not do. So God bless you, family. God bless you. We will continue to pray for you as we celebrate Laurence Xavier Gillespie. I'll now turn to service.
God bless you.
God bless you.
To the ministry. musicians is here in Austin, soloists, and to all others of you who have chosen to be a part of today's ongoing celebration. It is only befitting that we take this moment to say to each of you, thanks for the roles that you have so respectfully played in today's ongoing celebration. And it is our fervent wish that each of us will keep this family in prayer in the days to come ahead. May God's manifold blessings be with each of you.
Amen. Amen. I just have the Holy Spirit just urging me to do something before we prepare to depart, and that is to open the doors of the church.
Amen.
Because we realize that there might be someone who does not have a relationship with Jesus as Lord. And this just might be the opportunity to accept him. As I read earlier from Romans chapter 10, if thou shalt confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. So just for a moment, I just want to ask the question. Do you want to be saved today? Do you want to give your life to Christ today? And if the answer is yes, I ask you to stand up where you are. And the rest of us, I want us to bow and close our eyes as we prepare to pray. You see, we never know what role we play in someone coming to Christ. It might be a friend who introduces us to Christ through their lifestyle, through their ways, through their smile. It might be a Sunday school teacher. And it might even be a preacher. But there is a day of reckoning for all of us.
Yes.
And my belief, supported by Scripture, is that those of us in Christ are going to experience the same joy on the other side that Laurence is right now. So allow me to pray this time. Father, I thank you. I thank you, Lord. I thank you, Lord, as we have this great cloud of witnesses surrounding us, Father. For those who have walked this faith journey for many years, Father. Let us reflect back how it was for us when we first accepted Christ. The joy we had. Knowing that we no longer walk this life alone. And I just pray that someone has made a commitment today, a commitment to accept you, Lord. If not a commitment to accept you, but a commitment to consider you, Lord.
Yeah.
To reach out and talk to somebody about Jesus, accepting Christ as our Savior does not make us better than anybody else. It just means that we have accepted the gift God has bestowed upon us. And that gift is freely given to all those who confess and accept Jesus as Lord. Thank you, Father, for your Son. Thank you, Father, for salvation. Thank you, Lord. Amen. Amen. Amen.
Thank you.
Thank you.